yeah, okay.
Good?
We're trying.
Okay, so first things first, I've been told by our lovely Wisconsin friends that I have a quivering voice fairly above a whisper. So if you can't hear me tonight, please tell me to shout. Even though my voice may shake on the Wisconsin Supreme Court, I will be an unshakable champion of progressive values. Here's why. So, I am the grandson of Mississippi sheriffs. My father was forced out of school by poverty in the fifth grade, my mother in the 10th grade. But I grew up after many of your parents and grandparents had built the greatest and strongest middle class economy in the history of the world. We had great public schools, we had great public libraries, and I worked hard become one of the top lawyers in the country at doing what I love to do best, suing insurance companies. I know all that going means in this room by suing insurance companies, I suspect. So I've been fortunate. I've been a partner in three of the largest and most prestigious law firms in the country, and I've been hired by clients in 3 dozen states and 10 foreign countries. But I didn't learn my values in those fancy law firms. I learned my values, like many of you did, around the kitchen table with my parents, in ways I can remember most. In summer jobs, picking cherries for 8 cents a pound, alongside the families of my trained farm workers. Now, I may have only made $10 a day in those cherry orchards, but that experience taught me the most valuable lesson of my life, and that's this. Everybody wants and deserves opportunity for themselves and for their children. And in the essence, that is the first reason why I'm running for the Wisconsin Supreme Court. Because in the span of my adulthood, and at the beginning of the campaign, I said the short span of my adulthood, but it seems much longer now. In the span of my adulthood, equal opportunity for the children of people who struggle has disappeared in this country. It's been replaced by a system in which Senator Sanders did rightly say that almost all of the new income and wealth in this country goes to the top 1%. And everyone else is left working longer and harder for less and less. The inequity is a stamp. And our rubber stamp, Wisconsin Supreme Court, is part of the problem. Our Supreme Court has been looking out for big business and special interests rather than protecting the rights of regular Wisconsinites, and it needs to stop. The second reason I'm running for the Wisconsin Supreme Court is that this is the court that upheld a photo ID law that cost Hillary Clinton Wisconsin's electoral votes. Every major political issue in this country comes to you. to stay in this country. My third reason for running for the Wisconsin Supreme Court is that Donald Trump is backing our federal courts with young, right-wing ideologues. And if we are going to protect our basic rights, our workers' rights, our civil rights, our LGBTQ rights, our rights of reproductive choice, we need to look to our Supreme Court for those basic protections. So, the folks that are supporting me, three Democratic congresspeople, Congressman Steve Kagan from up this way, Congressman Mark Pocan, Congressman Dave Obey, many state political leaders like Senator Jennifer Shealey and Kathleen Falk from down in Madison, and organization, organized labor like AFT Local 212 out of Milwaukee and AFSCME, and great progressive groups like Our Wisconsin Revolution, the Sanders Group, Our Revolution. I'm one of eight candidates in the nation who have been endorsed by the Sanders Group, Our Revolution, and Citizen Action here in Wisconsin. Those organizations, those people, and I are ready for a fight to take back our Supreme Court and take back our state. And I hope you'll join us, and I hope you'll vote on Tuesday. Thank you.
Judge Dowling.
Thank you. Thank you for having me here. It's a pleasure to be here, and I've gotten to talk to a lot of you. I hope to meet whoever I haven't met yet. My name is Rebecca Dallet. I am a mom, three teenage daughters. I am an experienced attorney, and I'm an experienced judge. And I'm running for Wisconsin Supreme Court because we are living in a moment right now when our rights are under attack. Things we care about here in our state, things that make our state great, are being threatened. Clean air and water, equal protection under the law, workers' rights, women are under attack. And we have a broken Supreme Court. We have a Supreme Court that has had special interest money pouring into it for the last decade to elect or buy justice or a justice. And an example of how broken that court is the John Doe case. And that is a case where the money that helped to elect Justice Gableman appeared as a party in the case. That party had spent $2.25 million to elect him to our Supreme Court. And when he was asked to recuse himself, to step off the case, he refused. And then the court went on to shut down an entire investigation. And that was an investigation that all of us should care about. It was the coordination of politics and the special interest money. And as a former prosecutor, the fact that the court didn't even allow the prosecutors to conduct their investigation is unheard of. And these were prosecutors, by the way, that were Republicans and Democrats. And this was something that really all of us in Wisconsin should care about, good government, clean government. And yet the court did the bidding of the political allies, as it did in the John Doe case, as it's done in multiple cases, reaching end results in cases without actually applying the law, and doing so to further the interests of its political allies. There was a case that came out of the court in the past couple of weeks involving open records request, in which the court read things into the record, tried to reach an end result, and it appeared cared more about who was asking for those records and who was trying not to give them, as opposed to actually looking at the law. So that's the broken Supreme Court that I'm talking about. What we need at this moment in time is someone who has the experience and the values to step up and and that is why I am running. I have worked every day of my career as an attorney in our Wisconsin courtrooms for the people of the state of Wisconsin. I love it, it's my passion, and it's my joy to really serve our entire community. And I've done that in many ways. I have done that working as a prosecutor for 11 years. I prosecuted domestic violence cases. I was over at the U.S. Attorney's Office where I did a lot of appellate work, arguing cases, writing briefs, but I also prosecuted big gun and drug cases throughout the Eastern District. I then was over prosecuting sexual predators in multiple counties, and I did that for 5 years. I then went over to become a judicial official. I was first appointed as the presiding court commissioner for Milwaukee County, the first woman to ever hold that position in Milwaukee County, where I supervised 10 other judicial officers, and I was speaking with some individuals here earlier who had read the book Evicted. That was one of the main characters in that book. That was my job, was really trying to manage that court. We've done much better now. We have a project, an eviction project, to try to get people attorneys, which they desperately need in our courts, especially small claims. I did that for a year, and then I ran for and was elected to an open seat in Milwaukee County in 2008 and re-elected in 2014. The work I do every day is making the tough decisions. I don't work in a corporate boardroom. I don't work outside of our state. I work every day in our Wisconsin courtrooms listening to the issues that you all face every day. I have been in many different areas. I've been in domestic violence for 3.5 years and child abuse. I also supervise the other judges in that unit. I was in homicide and sexual assault, where all I heard every day for 2 years was homicide and sexual assault cases. I was in a gun court. I was drug court for a short time, and I've spent the last 2 years in a civil court where I absolutely have seen the issues that affect all of you sitting in this room. I have cases involving insurance companies, I have doctors testifying all the time, and I have had mental health practice cases. And so I've done the hard work, I've made the tough decisions, and that is why I am the one prepared at this moment to do the hard work on the Supreme Court, to review the cases that the circuit courts decide every day, and to do that in a way that is upholding the values that we all care about here in our state. I have also, if you look at the moment in time that we're in, I think it's important to consider as well the necessity of creating a level playing field. And so in our courts, I have had to do both the tough decision making of sending someone to prison when it needs to happen, and also the compassionate decision making, putting someone on probation, giving them a second chance, expunging a conviction, really doing those tough choices, making those decisions, and trying to further our courts. As I also work in our judicial college as an associate dean, I help to train our other judges. We choose topics that help to further some of these issues that we're facing, including juvenile justice reform, domestic violence. These are the topics we take on. And I train 50 judges a year as an associate dean in our judicial college. And I know what it's like also in this moment in time that we're living in, when we have women speaking out. I have spent a career of also making sure that some of these issues that do face some of the more vulnerable in our society and women and children in our society, especially harassment, sexual abuse, and I've stood up and empowered those women. I think we should keep in mind in our state as well, when we look at this moment in time and we look at how women are finally feeling comfortable to stand up against some of the way in which things have not been level, as they haven't been for many other groups in our community, that we also in our state only have all of our judges, only 1 in 5 are women still. And that's something that we need to work on in our state. We have a lot of things to work on. We have issues with respect to juvenile justice reform, mass incarceration, an opioid crisis that I know all of you are aware of as well. And it's things that we need to work on, and it's going to take someone who has the toolkit from day one to step up and make these policy decisions. decisions and make these tough decisions, and someone who has that experience, and that is me. And I'm prepared to do that. It's my honor to be running and to take all these skills and to hopefully have your support in making this important decision and important choice for our state. I have the support of over 350 elected officials, many to name, and including over 200 judges, many here in the Green Bay area. I'm proud of that because the judges come from all over. They come from urban and rural, they come from different backgrounds, and they know what it's going to take for this court, what it's going to take to change this court, what it's going to take to actually accomplish this work, that it takes someone who has done this work day in and day out, who knows what it takes to be on court, and to have living the decision making and also really understanding the issues that are faced every day by the people in our state. And so I'm proud to have their support. I hope to get your support, and I look forward to the questions that are going to be asked of, that you ask all of us tonight. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mayor. I'll pull up a couple of chairs here for the candidates to sit if you want to or stand, and we'll pose a question and have each one answer the question to the best of their ability. Anybody want to ask a question?
So one of the things I'm concerned about is voter rights, and the biggest thing I think I see going through the courts right now is gerrymandering. Obviously, we're waiting for a decision with the Wisconsin case at the Supreme Court, and we just saw the Pennsylvania Supreme Court strike down their partisan maps. So what are your viewpoints on gerrymandering and the court's ability to decide whether or not that's constitutional?
So gerrymandering is one of the greatest dangers to our democracy, period. Here's my concern. We all know about the Wisconsin case going out before the Supreme Court. It's been the subject of such news. One of my law partners, former law partners, was one of the great advocates in this country before the Supreme Court. Paul Smith argued that case. I have a lot of faith in Paul. But the case we all know also comes down to Anthony Kennedy. And that there are going to be four justices line up one way, this sure as clockwork, four others line up the other way, and Anthony Kennedy will make the difference. Unless Trump gets another judicial appointment. And then we may very well be back to square one. And you're right to mention the Pennsylvania case, because I've been talking about the Pennsylvania case for several months now, because Pennsylvania is the great example for us in Wisconsin. In November 2015, the people of Pennsylvania elected three progressive judges to their Supreme Court. And just last week, early in 2016, instead of filing the gerrymandering case for Pennsylvania in federal court like we did here in Wisconsin, the League of Women Voters in Pennsylvania filed their case in Pennsylvania's state court. The Supreme Court overturned Pennsylvania's maps like that once it got up before the Pennsylvania Supreme Court. And that's the importance of these Supreme Courts. And that's why it's so important that we change the Supreme Court, that we don't continue in the same direction we've been going. We need not to work with the judges on the Supreme Court right now, but actually over the next 2 years, by the spring of 2020, we can change the support. We can do what Pennsylvania did and create a progressive court. And then no matter what Donald Trump does, it won't matter for us. Because if the right case comes up before a progressive Supreme Court, they'll get to look at that case under the Wisconsin Constitution and see if it does violate the one person, one vote rule. And we'll determine our own destiny in this case. Thank you.
So gerrymandering is really power just begetting power. I mean, it's something that unfortunately has gone on not just in our state, but as we know in other states. And it's a huge issue, and certainly something that I disagree with. We should have the ability for everyone's vote to count. I see voting as one of the most important rights that we have in our country. It's our ability to make change, our ability to express ourselves, and without it, when you take away someone's vote, you really take away their ability to have a say. And so we should all care about it. Everyone should care about it, because it could have been Democrats as it was in other states, and here it wasn't. So it is important to talk about it, for people to understand it. Actually, one of my campaign consultants was one of the people who helped to find the litigants here, who took the case forward. They gerrymandered so badly in Wisconsin that they're really hopeful that it is going to get overturned. Hopefully that'll be a standard set by our Supreme Court, which hasn't been yet when it comes to the political gerrymandering. It's really been race-based or other types of gerrymandering. I heard on NPR about North Carolina had a 5K run that was a gerrymandering run, which, if you think about it, would give everyone the visual that you need. And I've been to these presentations because my campaign consultant has presented all over. There was one in Green Bay. It was at UW Green Bay. I went to it, where you got to actually see what it looked like. And by doing this run, I think it would really put into perspective that we're talking about three houses in a row, and we find out that two on either side go one way, and the one in the other, in the middle, goes another way, so the lines are drawn to take out the one in the middle. And so can you imagine this run that was kind of running around all over the place? But I think it would be a good visual for us all to understand, and to understand just how ridiculous this whole thing is. So certainly our ability to vote, something that absolutely needs to be protected at all costs.
One of the microphones and someone else with a question. Here's a comment, let me ask you a bit. The comment, I know this is upcoming, but maybe you have an opinion about the medical malpractice cap on pain and suffering. It's going to be challenged. And I just want to know your opinion.
You started out saying the exact thing. It's up and coming. And this is something really important when you think about Supreme Court justices.
Yes.
Well, here's the thing. We can talk to you about values. I'm talking to you about values. If I were to take a position on that case right now in front of you, two things. First of all, if I'm on the court then, someone who comes in front of me is not going to feel like they got a fair shake, right? Because it's going to look like I'm biased. But for the person I said it for or against, it's going to look like I'm biased. The second thing is I might actually have to step off that case. When we talk about recusal, it is such a big part of being a judge, and I know this because I do this, and I this is my life every day, is to make sure that the people who come in front of you really get a fair shake. They can't think you pre-decided that case. And they can't believe it, they can't think it, otherwise it's not fair. And if I were to make statements about a case that we know is pending, as the Columbia St. Mary's case, it is something that then I should potentially remove myself. If you want me to be there because you voted me in, if I have to step off the case, that certainly makes for an issue. So, I mean, here's the thing I'll tell you, okay? I'm the only one who's actually sat on these medical malpractice cases. I see what happens in these cases, and I will tell you the story of my last medical malpractice case because it was right when I was running, because I've been running since officially June 1st, but before that, there's a report that I had a couple cases, and one was since I've been running, where I heard the case, I gave everyone rulings throughout, and these cases take a couple weeks sometimes, you get a lot of experts, and job that I did. They're all supportive of my candidacy. And that's the kind of judge I am. I have support from criminal defense attorneys, from prosecutors, from medical malpractice cases, people who defend insurance companies, plaintiff's attorneys who bring suits, including medical malpractice. And so that is important to know the kind of judge I am and the kind of judge I'll be, and justice I'll be, is one that's fair, that's not pre-decided cases, and that's making sure that everyone gets a fair shake and knows they're going to get one. And I think that's what everyone wants, is to know that I haven't heard the exact, I haven't read the briefs, I haven't heard the arguments, and I'm certainly open to being convinced, based on the law, of what to do once it were to come in front of me.
So, I'm in a rare area of the agreement here. If there's a concrete case, like the medical malpractice case is, probably all know that Judge Darrell Kessler on the Court of Appeals wrote an opinion on medical malpractice caps this summer. And that case will likely come before the Supreme Court. And it won't be inappropriate because it's a concrete case that for anybody to look at their actual issues laid out between the parties, their real parties. And candidates or judges shouldn't be speaking. But this raises a larger, more fundamental issue about our democracy that I want to talk about. And that says, we do not hold our judges and judicial candidates accountable. And I mean it in this way. Judges occupy what are arguably the most powerful positions in our democracy. Our Supreme Court will have the final say on every political issue of the day. They'll have the final say on things like medical malpractice caps. And we begin in these campaigns that the race is nonpartisan and non-political, when in fact we all know that many decisions break down along political line. And pretending that these campaigns are not political has allowed stealth candidates on the right wing to say we're nothing but umpires, we're neutral, instead of telling you what their political values are. And as a small D Democrat, that offends me. Because if you're running for one of the most powerful offices in a democracy, voters deserve to know where you stand on the political and legal issues of the day. Because that will inform your judgment on how to enforce the Constitution of the state and the country. Now, I've been accused of rejecting because I've spoken and told voters my view on things like photo ID and gerrymandering and many other issues. But let's be clear about the distinction. Well, I have to refuse because I say that photo ID is a major threat to our democracy. How silly is that? We know that the photo ID case, the photo ID law in Wisconsin came before our Supreme Court 3 or 4 years ago, and every justice on the court signed on to an opinion that told their view of the constitutionality of photo ID. And somehow, a candidate for office would have to refuse because they speak the obvious that photo ID is a big danger to our democracy. We've allowed judges in our Supreme Court and bodies of judges and lawyers to deny our basic right in our democracy to say, if you want a position of power, tell me what you believe. Thank you.
Other questions?
I'll ask a question about the case that has passed. So I moved here from Pennsylvania in 2002, shortly after I came here. The Supreme Court of Wisconsin removed the cap on economic damages here in the state of Wisconsin. And to be honest with you, it's the reason I moved my entire family, five children, halfway across the country, was because I couldn't practice in Wisconsin or in Pennsylvania anymore, because it became economically unfeasible to practice because the non-practice rates were so high. And when I lived in Pennsylvania, I would every day get 15, 20, 30, and 100 letters in the mail trying to get me to go to other schools. When I came here, I got none of those. Literally within days of the Supreme Court removing the cap on economic damages, I started getting those out of our mails here. I mean, those people know. They know where we are. Since I've come here, I have another partner in my specialty who called me from Pennsylvania and said, is it really better there? I said, yes, it was. I said, you should come out and talk to us. I mean, it's an emotional thing to me because those, I mean, it's a big decision that your family has to make. So how would you guys, the two of you, have found in that case? I mean, thankfully, in my opinion, shortly after the Supreme Court removed the cap, you know, they replaced it with an inflation rider, essentially. They said, now it's constitutional. But now that, I mean, that stuff is constantly, you know, that as physicians, that should be so important to us. As you physicians that are here in Wisconsin and have never practiced anywhere else, I have no idea what it's like. My brother, who lives in Pennsylvania still, had to travel like 2 hours to find an obstetrician that he even felt might be able to care for his wife when she was pregnant with her second kid, because that, I mean, it's gotten that bad because everybody leaves those things. Everybody does. And states like Wisconsin, where you have those caps and those protections of doctors, which they are, it's not just doctors, it's businesses too. We all know that. But there has to be some same limit on the pain and suffering of words that people are aware of. I mean, the one that made me look to leave Pennsylvania was a case that found for, was a kid that was born with cerebral palsy, which is a terrible thing. Nobody wants a kid to be born with cerebral palsy. But the vast majority of those happen in utero, and no obstetrician or any other doctor. It's not their fault. But when you bring that kid out in front of a jury that has no limits on anything, they found for the family for $2.5 million for economic damages, $43 million for pain and suffering. What system can support that? So how do we remove that? I mean, if you look at those high-risk specialties, those people flood to states where there are protections because we can't afford it. I can never raise 5 kids. I don't live extravagantly. It's my nicest thought. I just would kind of like to be able to put my 5 kids in your college. I couldn't do that in Pennsylvania. There's not a chance in hell that I could have stayed in Pennsylvania. So my choice was leave my family and friends and everybody I grew up with, everybody I know, take her and my 5 kids and move to Wisconsin, which I'm happy we did. We're big Packers fans now. We love them. But the fact of the matter is, that's a case that's already gone through. How would you have decided on that? You can talk about that.
Except it's the same case that's currently pending.
So it's not. It's not.
That's the issue of.
So then why has it? How can we bring the same case?
That's the issue of having a court re-adjudicate a case that has become a system of law.
Well, here's
exactly. It's not the same. It can't be the same, or they wouldn't listen to it. So what would you have said about that case?
So, it's not a game, and I would say to you that what the decisions that, well, not to me, the decisions that I make are based on looking at what the legislature wrote and what they intended, and then applying the Constitution and seeing if it violates someone's rights. So the legislature has, well, the legislature, but that, this case now has come after that case, where the legislature then put these inflationary provisions on. So it is a different case in that way, but it's the same type of issue, and I don't have in front of me the exact argument. So what I say to you is that in front of me, you get a fair shake with no pre-decided decision, and it is about looking at the legislature, what they intended, those are the people that y'all elect, and then applying the constitutional provision and see if there's a violation of that constitution. And that's, honestly, for me to say otherwise now, the two things I pointed out before are really an issue. For me to say otherwise puts both you in a position that if you elect me to that job, and then I have to hear a case like that or that exact case or similar enough that I'm going to have to step off, and also that the people that come in front of me feel like it's a pre-decided issue. And so I would want to hear the briefs. I read the briefs. I would want to hear the arguments. I would research it. I would look at how the court decided before. I would look at what the changes the legislature made now and why. And did those resolve the issues? And those are all the things that I would do, the same way I do my work every day in my court, and the same way I know all of you want your judges and justices to do your work. You don't want your judges and justices to bring in their own political beliefs into a system where they aren't already there, where you're not, where there's, the Constitution is there, we all review it, but what if my political beliefs are different than your political beliefs? I mean, that's the problem we have now. We have a court that is bowing to political pressure and doing the bidding of their political allies, and they're pre-deciding cases, they're bringing in facts that weren't in front of the court, they're reaching conclusions and end results first, and then trying to rationalize how they got there, and that's not how judges are supposed to act, that's not how you want them to act. You want the court to be that check. It is a check on the legislature, it's a check on the governor, and that's what we have as our three-branch system, and that's what I would think.
So, Dr. Monitor, let me pay you the dignity that you, my fellow citizen, who's entitled to know my views on things, even when you disagree with me, because you may disagree with me and decide that I am wrong and I'm not someone you want to vote for. And that's probably the case, but in democracy, you're entitled to know my views on cases that were decided things. And I can tell you, it's been a while since then. Earlier case, but I thought the equal protection argument made by the majority was the compelling argument under the Constitution. I know that doesn't make sense, and I don't love the fact that the legislature has not figured out a way to remedy situations for doctors in the medical professions, and I might not deciding without working in the briefs that makes sense. But in my heart, when I read the decision of the majority in that case, I was more repentant than I was in this. And, you know, you just not disagreeing with this decision. I thought, I think that what was once the greatest democracy in the history of humanity. And we have become cornered serfs in this country. Stand up, ask those questions, and vote against the people who disagree. That's the only way we get our power back in this country from the Fox News of the world.
I appreciate both your views. I'll ask you another one. Yeah, that's different. Shortly after that, Governor Dora raided our injured patient and family compensation fund, which is money that was committed just by doctors. It's not taxed out. It's just by doctors. We had a very similar fund in Pennsylvania, ironically. It was called the PAT fund. got to have a certain amount of money in there that, you know, viable as an insurance plan. And I think the amount is $186 million. That's a fair amount of money. There was zero tax dollars. It was dollars that were paid just by doctors, just through their own practice insurance. And he said, well, we have a promise to buy there. We'll just take a test. You know, I mean, it's so insane, ridiculously unfair. And he did that as he was leaving office, maybe a year before Walker came in, I believe. And he did it to, in order to balance the budget, knowing that the next governor, knowing that the Supreme Court would find it unconstitutional, which they did, rightfully so, rightfully so. But they did find it unconstitutional, and Governor Walker then had to find a way to balance the budget, because this is a huge deficit and a piece of parity. I'm not saying I'm pro-Walker or pro-Doyle, but I can't cut Doyle on that rating of that one. I mean, what was right? That's another case that was in the past that's not pending. How would you have approved it? I mean, what's right about that when that's... I'm curious about that. I'd love to know. I mean, these are things that actually should matter to the people that are in this room. I care about gerrymandering and stuff too, but this is directly important. It should be incredibly important to people because you have no idea. You'll be moving your families other places too. So this is my state. I love this state. I love the Packers. I wouldn't want to live anywhere else. I do. But how would we have decided on that? I would love to do that.
I don't know how I would have decided on that one, because you described it in the calls. I'm sure you described it that way. I'm not that
type. It's just a fact.
But you have to remember that I read a lot of cases and this.
I read a lot of medical stuff. But it's fresh in my, that's fresh in my mind because it's fairly important.
I mean, I understand.
Right?
I mean, it's a fair point. Can I tell you how important that absolutely different group that you made to your colleagues?
Yes.
It's the gerrymandering stuff, the photo ID stuff, hugely important. But these economic issues that you raise, they're hugely important to you. And they're what our Supreme Court decide in case after case. They shape our economy, they shape our political system, and that's why it's so important for you to engage on issues like that. I have moved a call by government that doesn't just openly intend to tax people to pay for the services we need in this country, the healthcare that we need in this country, and instead use different methods to impose those burdens on you instead of imposing the burdens rationally on all of us or those who need help. So hopefully that in some measure gets you on the view of that type of
I read a lot of cases too. I don't have all of the memory of everything involved in that case, but it seems to me to be one where the money was clearly put in by that and was not available to our governor to balance the budget. And that's my take on it. Standing here, I have to reread everything to remember all of the circumstances.
It was actually that straightforward.
I mean, to me, it seems pretty obvious. That does not seem like a tough one.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I appreciate both of you. Yeah. All right, I'm done. Those are my two questions.
The State Medical Society spent a lot of time working to get that $2.5 million.
No, I mean, that's a lot of money.
Huge amount. And it's insane. I mean, that's insane. That we even had to go through.
Right, well, that's what the sport's for. I mean, that's what the sport's for. We're there when the governor, no matter who it is, whatever side they're on, or the legislature oversteps their bounds and does something that violates the Constitution. that's the job of the voters. That's why it's so important. That's why this election is so important. And it's glad you're here to ask this question.
Thank you.
Another question?
Understanding the passion? Okay. Well, I'll tell you what role I have is living, understanding compassion for over 20 years in our courts. I can tell you stories of things I've heard that you would never want to hear in your entire life. I have unfortunate images in my mind of terrible things people have done to each other or terrible harms people have suffered. So my compassion both comes from my upbringing as in a single mom household, taking care of my sister and working my way through college and working to get a full scholarship to law school and working my way and continuing in my life. But it's also the people that I have met, over 10,000 cases in my courtroom, and that my compassion is absolutely founded on all of those stories. And every person that comes in front of me that has suffered a harm, because our courts are there for the vulnerable. If you think about it, none of you want to be there unless you're getting married or adopting a baby. And unfortunately, those things don't happen quite as often. I'm doing weddings on Valentine's Day, because that's what we do. But honestly, if you're there because something terrible has happened, or you're being sued because something terrible has happened, it may not be your fault, but I mean, that's why you're here. So my compassion is totally full, and I have applied it in every way, shape, and form to all the cases and all the people beside me and in front of me every day, the best I possibly can in every case. And I will continue to do that.
So it's supposed to be about justice. It's not just us. Said compassion masks a role. Any of the tip that we have, so it's a three candidates, all of us that we have throughout the team. Who is your favorite system? And sometimes they ask it all time, or sometimes currency. I end up being just this Thurgood Marshall if they ask for all time. Because Thurgood Marshall with the struggle, he had compassion while on the court in his decision making because he lived that struggle and if it's just those who are deserving all office of the son and so on because she grew up circumstances, she makes the struggle do. Thurgood Marshall said something that not most people, but a lot of conservative legal scholars don't give credit for his concerns. But he stood out his judicial philosophy. He said, do what you think is right, and let the law judge. And what he meant by that is this, our judgment is informed by what we believe is right, what we believe is just in our society. And I would hope that I dropped. I hope I would bring the same feeling that I felt when I watched my father as when I was a high school student, and I watched him struggling to write imperative in the English language. Not because he was not smart, but because he had to leave school in fifth grade because of poverty. Hopefully that informs my decisions on my next phase.
Anything else?
It does in many ways, but you know, we're not, I hear original intent. I'm sorry, Dr. Hecker asked, what was my thought, and Judge Gallup's thought on this idea of originalism that's most associated with recently deceased Justice Antonin Scalia. The idea that you interpret the Constitution in the same manner the framers would have interpreted it in their day, as to specifics, not as to values, but as to specific situations. And look, one of the great U.S. Supreme Court justices who had such a flair for life was a guy named Robert Jackson from upstate New York. If you remember, Justice Jackson was the original Nuremberg prosecutor to Ali Sarkar, U.S. Supreme Court. And he said originalism was like Joseph trying to interpret the dreams of the faith on very skin. And I think that about captures my view on originalism too. It's my view, right here, that just trying to impose 17th century thinking on a modern society that people aren't interested in anything but in the 17th century. So, but one other thought on this thought is civil war in this country over an originalist interpretation of the Constitution. The U.S. Supreme Court in the 1850s looked back in the 1780s when the Constitution was being written and decided this called Dred Scott versus Safe. And asked if an African-American person could ever be a citizen. And their answer was the hallmark of originalism, and it barely destroyed our country. But on the fields of Antietam, on the fields of Vicksburg, as a country, we won that battle, that we wanted to rule by the dead man of the past in deciding what rights and wrongs.
So our Constitution from 1787 needed to live in that day, and it needs to live now. In 1787, women couldn't vote, African Americans couldn't vote, they weren't even considered a whole person. So we absolutely need a constitution that is brought, it served the founding fathers, believe it served the time of 1787, but that they also intended for it to be used today. And I think anyone that says otherwise, I don't know how you can really, in our day and age, when you deal with issues that they didn't have then, cell phones, airplanes, drones. I did a presentation about drones and search and seizure. How would you possibly say you're going to justify the words of the 1787? You have to bring it into today's day. And I think Ruth Bader Ginsburg, I don't have her quote in front of me, I really like her quote, but it's essentially what I summarized, which is, the founding fathers absolutely intended the Constitution to be useful then and useful now and applying now to what's going on in our society. And I think that's just the way it has to be.
Question? Anything else?